Madam Speaker, let me thank members for their insights over the past few days. Many have put their minds to the question of how Singapore can make a good living in this changing, volatile world. And many have put their hearts into the question of how we can support Singaporeans to live with strength, confidence, fulfillment. I value and appreciate this. As do my ministerial colleagues, who will take up the specific issues during the Committee of Supply. In my budget speech, I said that Budget 2016 is the beginning of our journey towards SG 100. We want a future where our economy is abuzz with innovation and enterprise, and where our society is alive with caring and resilience. After listening to members, it is clear to me that not only do we know where we are heading, we are committed to getting there together. Many members have rallied to the call for partnership. The urgency and conviction behind members' support for partnership have been palpable. This is most encouraging and promising for our future. So we know our direction. We also know where we come from, the road we have journeyed to get here. Mr. Heng Swee Keat is right about our hard truths. We have very real limitations as a small, resourceless country. Resourceless though we may be, we also inherit a legacy of resourcefulness from our pioneers, and whose wealth of experience and hardiness serve as our down payment for the future. We can be held back by our limitations, or we can be, like our pioneers, break through our limitations. Our pioneers have shown us that where there is a will, there is no way you will stop a hardworking Singaporean from doing the extraordinary for family, home, and country. We know where we want to go. We know where we come from. It is the in-between, the getting there, that is full of unknowables. One thing we cannot decide, the landscape in which we journey. Mr. Lee Yi-Shian shared vividly how the world is changing. The changes are coming so fast and furious that no one can say what the road ahead will be like. But even if we cannot tell the lay of the land ahead, there are many things that are up to us. How will we conquer each obstacle before us? How will we weather the storms? How will we pick ourselves up when we stumble? And how will we help our fellow travellers to go forward? In this debate, I've been struck by how many members spoke about our values, our mindset, our culture. And I certainly appreciate these points. Let me put what members have said together in one word: spirit. It is a spirit in which we do things, the spirit in which we take this journey, that will keep us true to where we came from and carry us through to where we want to go. From members' speeches, we can sum this up as a spirit of enterprise and caring. Enterprise. Do not be held back by what appear to be limitations, to overcome challenges, innovate, and stay resilient, seize opportunities. Caring, to keep our Singapore a warm and giving home, where we help one another through our personal challenges, where we can each achieve our best, reach our dreams, and go on to inspire and serve others. We know where we came from, we know where we want to go, and we are committed to moving forward together in partnership, in this spirit of enterprise and caring. Now, I'll speak on how Budget 2016 enlivens this spirit of enterprise and caring for our journey of the next 50 years. Let me begin with the economy, which many members have spoken on. Mr. Chong Kee-hiong, Ms. Sun Xie-ling, Mr. Yi Jia-Xing, and Dr. Tan Wu-Ming talk about global trends affecting Singapore and how our economy must remain outward-looking and forward-looking. Minister Chan Chun Sing, Mr. Sitoh Yih Pin, spoke on short-term challenges facing our economy and the impact this will have on our businesses and workers. Mr. Patrick Tay and Mr. Saktiandi Supat provided suggestions on how we can transform our economy and what role the government ought to play, a point which Ms. Jessica Tan also raised earlier. Now, these are all very valid points, and I thank members for their thoughtful views on the subject. Mr. Liang Eng Hua said that, I quote, "To achieve better lives and a stronger nation, we need to have the means and resources to get there." And this is a timely reminder of why we need to grow the economy. And this is what the budget seeks to address. And this is also why we've set up the Committee on a Future Economy. Many members have spoken in support of for our SMEs. And indeed, this budget is tilted towards supporting SMEs. There are over 180,000 SMEs, accounting for nearly two-thirds of our employment. So the success of our SMEs matter to our people's jobs and well-being. SMEs provide a range of services that are important for our daily life and add buzz to our neighbourhood. Some will grow to be future large firms. And even if they don't, our society will be richer to have the opportunity where people just try and try to do something. And in fact, we want our SMEs to do well. We want them to succeed. We want a vibrant SME sector. But in order to support our SME, we must recognize that they range from micro-enterprises in the heartlands to fairly sizable firms with an international presence. Some are in sectors that are doing well, while others are facing difficulties. Hence, as many of you pointed out, we cannot have a one-size-fits-all approach. And as Mr. Louis Ng noted, different people have taken away different messages away from this budget. And reactions across the different news outlets have also been different, even the headlines. Now, listening to all your comments, however, there is a common thread running through on how we can help firms and workers. The common thread is to nurture, celebrate, and reinforce the spirit of enterprise, and not undermine it even as we provide support. To go for long-term vitality and not short-term fixes. A business leader once asked me this very intriguing question. In every place, he said, from the poorest neighborhood in Africa to the richest precinct in Silicon Valley, there are firms that succeed and firms that don't. Why? Good question. Last year, both the SBF and the SCCCI honored companies and business leaders from our founding days. The SBF award recipients include long-standing names such as Shaw Theatre and Yeo Hyap Sing. The SCCCI award recipients include the founders of Lim Teck Lee, Pan United Corporation, and Sing Loon Holdings. These companies and pioneers started out in an environment with few grants, incentives, and agency to support them, a point which Engineer Lee Bee Hua also raised. In many cases, they started from scratch, or as the Chinese say, bai shou qi jia. So whether you look across countries or you look across our own history, or across time in our own history, why do some firms succeed while others don't? The common element for success is this, the spirit of enterprise. This is the critical element needed for economic vibrancy in Singapore and anywhere in the world. You see, running a business is a complex thing because you'll be faced with myriad problems, unforeseen problems. And the more problems one solves, the closer one, the further one gets ahead. And solving problems allow the entrepreneur to develop the entrepreneurial instinct to then see opportunities where others see problems. Associate Professor Randolph Tan hits the nail on the head when he said that the principles that have propelled us since independence are, and I quote, self-reliance, openness, and a determination to remain updated and relevant. And these are what nurture a spirit of enterprise. One element of this spirit of enterprise is the need to look outwards and forward, to see challenges and opportunities in the world around us. So I'm very encouraged to hear members speak of the implications of these changes. Mr. Elysian, he reminded us of how robotics is shaping the global economy. Now, which country in the world has the most industrial robots? Well, the country with the most people in the world, China. It is astounding, isn't it? So if even China, at a lower level of wages, is automating, what does this mean for us? Minister Chan Chun Sing related how e-commerce is changing the face of retail. As consumers, we want the best deals. So I've heard of many people who go to a shop to view, feel, and try products, and then go home to purchase it online at a lower price. I don't know whether members here do that too, or you must have heard of people who have done so. So retail shops are under stress, and some in the sector are looking ahead to the future. Funan Digital Life Mall, known for years and years for selling IT products, is closing to reshape itself to become an experiential creative hub. Mr. Liang Yehua cited insourcing trends in both the US and China, and this means that the global supply chain, which we are part of, is shrinking. China and the US will produce more and more of their goods at home. So how do we continue to create value within the world among the world's biggest markets? So in this regard, Mr. Heng Chee Hao and Mr. Lee Hsien reiterated that economic transformation is urgent and critical. We must indeed support our businesses' spirits of enterprise to look outward to the world and forward to the future and take this task of transformation urgently. At the same time, many members, such as Mr. Saktiandi Supat, spoke of the challenges faced by our SMEs in the near term. Some members, such as Mr. Ang Hin Kee, Mr. Gan Thiam Poh, and Mr. Zaki Mohamad, have asked for more support for SMEs in this period. I appreciate these concerns. One way of supporting this spirit of enterprise is to make sure that viable firms can survive this period of cyclical weakness. Otherwise, we lose precious capabilities that are difficult to rebuild later. And our people's livelihoods could also be at stake. This is why this year's budget is carefully calibrated to address cyclical concerns without impeding restructuring. And members such as Mr. Ong Teng Koon have expressed support for this support package. Now, costs remain a concern for many SMEs. Some members, such as engineer Dr. Lee Bee Hua, spoke about rental costs. In fact, rental costs have declined over 2015. Retail, office, and industrial rents fell by 4.1%, 6.5%, and 2.1%, respectively. But I appreciate that the experience can be different for different firms in different locations. Now, that is why we are careful to shape the overall macroeconomic conditions to be supportive of growth, to make sure that we do not price ourselves out of the global markets. So we released more space, implemented anti-speculative measures, and calibrated our exchange rates carefully. And these are medium-term measures, and we are seeing results. We are seeing results in terms of supporting firms, even in the cost area. Now, others, such as Dr. Lily Neo, spoke about manpower costs. Wages have been rising, which is good for our workers. Our workers do look forward to rising wages, but it puts pressure on businesses, especially those with lower margins. We must understand where these cost pressures come from. They are fundamentally based on demand and supply. Our supply of land and labor is limited, but the demand for our resources is growing, which in fact indicates that our economy is still growing. So prices are bid up. So while we should be careful not to price ourselves out of the global market, we must accept that we cannot be a low-cost location. Even China, which used to be a cheap place with its vast land and population, 1.3 billion people, is experiencing rising business costs. Their businesses are automating, their businesses are moving out from coastal region to inland, as well as to cheaper locations outside China. So we cannot permanently subsidize costs. All firms, large or small, in whatever sector, must compete on productivity and innovation. And this is the way to reinforce the spirit of enterprise and to build vitality in our firms for the long haul. This is how we will compete. Enterprising firms understand this and build their business models with these hard constraints in mind. I fully understand that restructuring is painful, but it is necessary so that our finite resources will not be trapped in zombie businesses, as Mr. Ong Teng Koon warned, and our workers, in particular our workers, will not be trapped in firms, in sectors with poor prospects. So our concern about restructuring is ultimately a concern for our workers, our people. And in this regard, several members have spoken at length on what we should not do to undermine the spirit of enterprise. Ms. Tana Lechmi and Mr. Ang Wei Neng, Ms. Tana Lechmi and Mr. Ang Wei Neng cautioned that government support should not become a crutch. And as Dr. Lim Wee Kiak pointed out, firms should not have the impression that government will eliminate risk and bail out any firm in trouble. And Mr. Vikram Nair also cautioned against institutionalizing subsidies to industries, as they can be difficult to remove. Now, I appreciate members' comments on how we can best support our firms in this period of weakness. But a business leader, Mr. Stephen Koh, put it to me this way. He said, you know, government support is like push starting a car that has gotten stuck in a difficult patch. It can get the car going again, but the government cannot be pushing the car for miles and miles. You'll run out of resources. So once the car is moving, it has to rely on its own engine to go for the long haul. Wise words from a business leader who has been in business for a long time. To go back to the question of why some firms succeed, we also observe that some economies and some regions of big countries produce more winners than others and have been able to create many more good jobs. So again, why is this so? What is happening in these places? Well, in these economies, the governments have played an important role, an enabling role, enabling enterprising individuals and businesses to go further than they could have on their own. And I think Ms. Jessica Tan just touched on this point and said it well. They have created a stable political and business environment with clear policy and regulations, invested in R&D and first-class infrastructure, and most of all, in their people through education, through lifelong learning. They have partnered business to grow the economy while allowing market forces to work to channel the resources to the most productive firm. Businesses and government have come together to achieve external economies of scale, or as the academics put it, the Marshallian externalities, a point which Professor Hun Hen Teck recently and I discussed. So in short, the government's work to strengthen the spirit of enterprise in our firms and workers. In this budget, we seek to help entrepreneurial firms scale and internationalize, support automation to build capacity, and encourage innovation. And we seek to support our heartland shops through the revitalization of heartlands. And we seek to provide a broad range of support to SMEs so that everyone has the opportunity to upgrade, to raise capability, to compete. And for our people, we seek to support the development of deep skills and match this to growth areas. Engineer Dr. Li Bihua sums it up well on how we can support the spirit of enterprise and how we can aim for long-term vitality. And I quote, "In the short term, Singaporean firms might rightly expect some fish from governments to keep their workers fed. But ultimately, the country will run out of fish if they don't develop bigger, smarter, and faster fishing ships to get fishers from international waters." And indeed, the government can help businesses to develop bigger, smarter, and faster ships. But ultimately, the captains of industry must navigate this ship and help our firms go the distance. As we move to the next phase of our restructuring journey, we will adopt a more targeted approach to helping firms. Different firms and industries have different needs. So to drive real transformations, we need to calibrate our support to the needs of each firm and each sector. And I think Ms. Denise Pua made this point about no cookie cutter approach. So I thank many members for your support for the shift from broad-based approach to a more targeted, sector-focused approach to supporting industry. Now, several members spoke on the productivity and innovation credits, or PIC. Was it effective or was it abused? Now, notwithstanding some of the reports, let me clarify that the PIC has in fact largely achieved its objectives. From the start, PIC was designed to raise awareness among SMEs about productivity and, importantly, to get SMEs to undertake basic productivity efforts, to get started. As of January 2016, 102,000 companies have benefited from PIC. So this is about 70% of all active companies in IRIS's records for the year of assessment 2014, a very, very considerable number. And today, around 90% of SMEs are taking steps to increase their productivity, according to a survey by SCCCI. So with this broad-based take-up of productivity initiatives, we are now ready to move on to the next phase of restructuring through the Industry Transformation Program. Now, some may ask, whether are we sure that the Industry Transformation Program will succeed? As I said before, there is no textbook answer to policy. There's no textbook answer to innovation. So in government, we too need to embrace the spirit of enterprise. We have some clear ideas of where we need to go, what we need to do. But we must be humble, and we have to figure it out dynamically, learning and improving and improvising as we go along, and working in partnership with businesses which know well what are needed. And based on our consultation, the consensus at this point is that this is the best way forward. Mr. Liang Eng Hua rightly pointed out, together with several others, that implementation will be key. And I couldn't agree more. This industry transformation will not be easy. As industry needs are complex, it will require strong partnerships. We have the advantage of trust among firms, unions, and governments. We know that if we don't dare to try, we will certainly fail. But if we have the guts to try, we have a good chance of succeeding. And if we go at it together, we have the best chance of succeeding. Now, some members have asked whether is there a spirit of enterprise in Singapore firms? Is it well and alive in our firms, in our people? So let me highlight some examples. With your permission, Madam Speaker, may I display some slides on the LED screens?
Yes, please.
Now, this is Wee Meng Construction, a local steel fabrication SME serving the construction industry. Like other SMEs, they could not attract young and skilled Singaporeans. So they did three things. First, they adopted a new robotic cutting system, which increased productivity of the cutting process by 18 times. Second, they mapped their productivity gaps to identify improvements. And third, they trained their staff to operate the new machines, increased the pay of trained staff by 10 to 20%, and built an in-house robotics team. Now new Singaporean employees joined the firm, and they reduced the hiring of foreign workers. And their next step is to secure overseas steel fabrication projects. So Wee Meng Construction is a good example of how we can automate, develop our people, scale up, and internationalize. The technology that Wee Meng Construction has adopted is scalable across the sector, and we will support such upgrading capability. So firms like Wee Meng give us hope. By turning adversity into opportunity, they embody the forward-looking resilience and enterprise that has carried Singapore this far. Now, another very good example which I came across recently is Jean and Jeremy, a mother and son duo who own JMD Pacific, very near here at Peninsula Shopping Centre. Now, in the picture that you see, Jeremy is the young man, and Jean, the mother, is a young lady, is a lady there. I think they will do well to sell anti-aging product as well. A traditional retailer, growth was slow, and e-commerce was drawing sales away from brick-and-mortar stores such as theirs. So Jeremy, who graduated from university, suggested to his mother to list the products online and use social media to do marketing. And this immediately opens up to a wider group of customers. And Jeremy also helped to bring in sports and lifestyle products new to Singapore, and they became the exclusive distributor for some brands now carried by big stores such as Challenger, Courts, and Guardian. And as sales moved online, they digitized their processes and ventured into overseas markets and into new product lines such as sports and lifestyle products. So to me, it's an inspiring story of the transformation of family businesses and how, you know, even a retail store can take advantage of technology, of e-commerce, and to move ahead. At the industry level, successful transformation can benefit all firms within the industry. Now, I spoke of the spirit of partnership in the budget statement, and firms can achieve more when they work together on common goals. Now, some people have asked, after I raised this, why would competitor firms find it in their interest to cooperate? But firms can cooperate and compete all at the same time. They can compete in ways to differentiate themselves from one another in different niches of the market with different views on who has the best product or service. But they can cooperate on ways to help them all drive down costs, grow the market, and grow global mindshare. Now, an example is a collaborative industry project on 3D additive manufacturing, where companies come together to share access to the state-of-the-art equipment at the Singapore Institute of Manufacturing Technology, or SIMTEC. Now, SIMTEC also works with companies to identify key technologies that can drive their future growth. For example, they helped Wavelength Optoelectronic, an SME manufacturer of infra-optics components, develop a first-of-its-kind miniaturized laser equipment. So this new system helped to grade the quality of the products, and the company's annual sales have increased by over 20% since. The system has now gained interest from several other manufacturers, and Wavelength Optoelectronic has been transformed from an equipment trader and component manufacturer to an original equipment manufacturer. Quite a transformation. So again, a good example of how industry-focused institutions can generate value for firms in their respective sectors. Now, for us to to have more of such efforts. Strong sector institutions with committed leadership are needed to drive collaborations and build up shared resources in each sector. So under the Industry Transformation Programme, a government agency will be appointed to coordinate efforts and develop a transformation map for each sector. By working with industry, the reach of this programme can be greatly expanded. Now, if private actors in each sector are willing to step forward to do something for the industry, the government is very willing to support them. Today, there are over 300 trade associations and chambers, some with more capabilities than others. Mr. Lee Hsien highlighted the Singapore Furniture Industry Council as a TAC which has been effective in helping the entire industry to upgrade. Now, I agree with many of you that not all TACs are playing the role that they could reach out to firms in their industries. But where they are willing to step up, we will support them in their capability development through schemes such as LEAD and LEAD Plus. Mr. Leon Pereira suggested that a tool to benchmark productivity would be useful for SMEs. Now, in fact, there are productivity calculators available to firms. One is Spring's Way to Go portal. And in addition, Singapore Business Federation, in partnership with DP Info, recently launched the Holistic Industry Productivity Scorecard, or HIPS in short. So if you go into this website, the tools help companies measure the productivity based on key indicators and allow them to benchmark themselves against the industry norm. And since the launch of HIPS 4 months ago, 80 companies have used this scorecard, and SBF aims to reach 30,000 SMEs by 2020. Now, you see, this is an example of how an industry association, a business chamber, is taking the lead in transformation. So while I appreciate that many members have called for governments to do more, I think we should also celebrate such efforts by industry associations that are not told what to do, but you know, they take leadership, they take ownership, they know what the industry needs, and they work together to create value for their members. Now, Mr. Ang Wei Neng and Dr. Teo Ho Pin spoke about how some SMEs may have difficulties attracting talent. In 2013, MTI launched the SME Talent Program to help match SMEs with students. I'm happy to say that since then, more than 450 job matches have been made and over 1,000 internships have been conducted, benefiting over 190 enterprises. Now, the Singapore Industry Scholarship is another joint initiative between firms in multiple industries and government that addresses the issue of talent recruitment. Now, I'm very proud of this scheme because I launched it in 2012 because I felt strongly, like many of you in this house, about building Singaporean leaders in industry. So since its launch, around 50 organizations are on board and more than 350 scholarships have been awarded. Incidentally, one important criterion which I use for having firms on this is that it's not about a scholarship, it's about mentorship. Are you willing to develop the talents that you have? If you are, you are on board. If you are not, then we will not admit you to this scheme. Now, I'm also very encouraged that business leaders themselves have been avid about mentoring and sharing experiences. And three examples come to mind. First, the Bosses Network, set up by Mr. Hong Ting Liang, which brings SMEs together. Second, the SBF, the Workforce Advancement Federation, started by Mr. C.B. Chan of Goodrich Global, which focuses on learning and building a sustainable workforce. And third, the Business Leaders Alumni Club, run by Ms. Susan Chong of GreenPack, which organizes sharing sessions with CEOs. So industry transformation, sector by sector, can be promising. Now, I want to thank Ms. Denise Pua for her suggestion of flexibility and enlightened partnership, and your point about, you know, the need to have targeted approach and the 3A framework. Indeed, the 3A framework is a way for us to look at how we can support the spirit of enterprise. Now, I also like to thank Associate Professor Randolph Tan for cautioning against the risk of entrenchment of sector-based interest. And indeed, we must guard against this. Even as firms cooperate, they must not engage in anti-competitive practices. Now, let me now speak on the topic of innovation. I thank Ms. Chia Yong-Yong, Ms. Ting Pei Ling, and Professor Madhav Mohan for their thoughtful suggestions. Some members, such as Ms. Kwek Xiaoyin, said quite rightly that building a culture that supports innovation is critical. The culture comes before strategy. Now, I'm optimistic that we can do this. Last Friday, I visited the hangar by NUS Enterprise, as well as Launchpad at One North, two innovation zones which bring together professors, students, and innovators. And I quite like the name of hangar in NUS because, you know, this is where ideas take flight. Now there, I met people together to build who are building exciting startups, many, many good ones. So let me just highlight two. First, Rabbit Ray. You may have read this in the Straits Times earlier, which seeks to make a difference for children seeking medical treatment. This is Ms. Esther Wang, the founder. So she designed a patient engagement design in the form of a device, in the form of a toy rabbit that explains medical procedures to children in a medically accurate but relatable and comforting way. And for this, Esther won the Shelf LiveWire Top 10 Innovators Global Award. The second example is Water Room, which seeks to make a difference to those in disaster and relief areas in need of clean water. Now, there are startups that has developed a portable water filtration system that can turn dirty water into drinkable water, filtering out bacteria in the process, and in the same time that you would take to run it from a tap. The young man who showed me gamely drank the water to show me that, you know, it works. Yeah. And in fact, it has allowed it to be deployed in disaster and rural areas. Now, why do I highlight these two examples? What struck me about both startups is that their innovation starts with the aim of meeting a human need. In the case of Rabbit Ray, the innovation was less in technology than in design, and with a focus on improving the lives of children seeking medical treatment. And in fact, Esther is now working on the door that helps children who have to undergo chemotherapy. And in the case of Water Room, it is to meet the need for potable water for residents of disaster hit zones and in rural areas, in the poor areas of the world. So I'm very happy to have young people like this who understand that innovation is not just about technology, it's not about, you know, some gizmo, but really it is about meeting human needs, making the world a better place, and how they can make an impact to the lives of others and make an impact in the world. And in fact, there are many other examples. There are many examples of creative people with the desire, skills, and belief to make a difference. And so how do we nurture this creative environment that allows innovations to flourish? Now, I agree with Mr. Asmoon Ahmad and several others that curiosity needs to be stimulated from young. And indeed, we've been making changes to our education system to nurture this. But meanwhile, we must continue to improve the environment for innovation to thrive. And to do that, we need to connect the many dots. And that is why we set up SG Innovate, to connect innovators to smart money, mentors, markets, and experts in the R&D area. Now, the thrust of my budget speech on innovation is that innovation must be pervasive and must be present in all sectors of the economy and in all firms, including SMEs. And that is why I mentioned there's no sunset industry, only sunset thinking, a point which Mr. Thomas Chua elaborated very, very well. And that's why we also placed resources on the revitalization of the heartland. So it is never about confining innovation to enclaves, as Associate Professor Daniel Goh seems to suggest. And to paraphrase Professor Madhav Mohan, the process of innovation is not a precise science. It's an art that requires us to be patient, take the long-term view, persevere, and continuously adapt. We need to change mindsets, as many of you have said, but it is an art, and we have to be patient. Now, let me now turn to readying our people for the future. Many members have spoken about the impact of the economy on people and jobs. Several, such as Mr. Yitia Singh and Mr. Zaki Muhammad, have asked whether there will be good jobs available as our economy evolves. Others, like Mr. Chan Chun Singh and Assistant Professor Madhav Mohan, were concerned about whether our people will have the skills to take up good jobs. Mr. Melvin Yong, Mr. Gan Tiampo, and others also spoke on how we can help retrenched workers or new entrants into the workforce find the right jobs. In fact, all over the world, people are concerned about jobs as major economies grapple with job losses and structural unemployment. In some countries, there is overcapacity. China is rebalancing its economy from heavy industry to services and may lay off over 1.5 million workers from the coal and steel industries alone. In other places, such as the US or Europe, underinvestment has held back economic and employment growth. Underemployment and structural unemployment due to skills mismatches are issues that many economies are grappling with. We are in a better position because we have invested in creating jobs and enabled our people to acquire relevant skills. Our overall unemployment rates are low compared with other countries. Ms. Sylvia Lim said that the 1.9% figure for the unemployment rates does not tell the whole story. But the picture doesn't change much, even if we look at resident unemployment or any other indicators. At the end of 2015, the unemployment rate was 2.9% for residents and 3% for citizens, which most economists would regard as close to full employment, as there's always some degree of frictional unemployment in any economy. Now, the labor force participation rate has risen from 66.2% in 2010 to 68.3% in 2015, which is higher than the OECD average. If my memory is not wrong, the OECD average is about 60%. So we have a very high labor force participation rate. And importantly, real median income has grown by 3% per annum over the last 5 years. Now, overall, our economy is still creating jobs. The ratio of job vacancies to job seekers remains above one. And in fact, if you go to job sites, you know, whether it's indeed.com or the MOM Jobs Bank, there are many jobs being advertised, including, of course, in the classified ads. But I understand the anxieties of Singaporeans about jobs, because it's not just about jobs, it's about our families. We cannot take for granted that there will be good jobs and incomes in the future. To address these concerns, we need an approach. We need a coherent approach. And this is, first, create the right jobs. Create the right jobs. Second, develop the right skills. And third, enable the right match. So it's about right jobs, right skills, right match. Right jobs, right skills, right match. So first, creating jobs. And even more, creating the right jobs. Now, Associate Professor Randolph Tan said, and I quote, "It is no mean feat to continue to generate jobs in an increasingly sophisticated economy packed into one of the most congested cityscapes in the world." Indeed, this is no mean feat. We not only need to create jobs, but given our high cost structure, given the high level of wages already, to create jobs of high value that meet the aspirations of Singaporeans. And to do that, our firms must be competitive and productive. Now, I showed this slide when I presented the budget statement. Now, this scatter plot shows average productivity and average wage per worker. So these are actual wages paid to workers. And you can see that it is an upward sloping line, meaning that the higher the productivity, if you look at the right, top right corner, the higher the productivity of the firm, the higher the wages that they pay to each worker. So it shows that productive firms generally pay higher wages. And therefore, when we talk about industry transformation, this is why industry transformation is so important. Why we need to transform enterprises, transform industry, and transform to innovation. Because this is the engine, this is the means for us to create a better life for our workers, to create better jobs for our workers. And all these changes require changes which require us to create new companies, create new jobs, and which will require new skills. So, you know, some members have asked, how do this industry transformation program, you know, is it just about helping firms? And some workers have asked, does it help us? So I want to emphasize this very important point, that ultimately, these programs are about helping our workers, helping our people. Now, as part of this transformation, firms must also redesign jobs and develop their staff. Several MPs, such as Mr. Ang Hin Kee and Mr. Melvin Yong, pointed out how important it is for firms to automate and redesign jobs and train their staff in an integrated way, so as to bring out the best in every employee and allow everyone to catch up. And I'm happy to say that many firms are doing this and reaping the benefits. So let me share another example. So take Fine Matter, a precision engineering firm I recently visited, where I met Winston Ng, a young polytechnic graduate who joined Fine Matter after his course in mechatronics at the Singapore Polytechnic. After working for 5 months, he was sent by Fine Matter for advanced training in Germany, and upon returning to Singapore, Winston noticed that one of the processes used to bend needles for semiconductor wafer testing could be done better. So he conceptualized a way to automate it, then worked with a systems integrator to develop a machine for it. And as a result of this innovation, productivity increased 4 times, and operations run 24 hours a day. Now, the machine also reduced the training time required for the process from 9 months to 1 week. Now, look, investing in one young man, sent him to Germany, came back, increased productivity 4 times, reduced training from 9 months to 1 week. You know, staff and the other staff are now redeployed to higher value-added jobs within the firm. So, Winston's training at the Polytechnic and in Germany, combined with his on-the-job experience, enabled him to generate insights and innovate successfully. And that is why I've been emphasizing that employers play a very, very critical role in enabling, in not just upgrading their firms, but really in developing their people. And investments like this, the care that takes into investing in people, ultimately pays dividends for the firms. And a young man like Winston gets a better prospect in life. A young polytechnic graduate that is able to conceptualize a machine with such impact. So we must continue to build conducive workplace environments that empower staff to continue learning and improving. So I hope that all firms will invest in their people, young and old, and start a virtuous cycle of higher skills, higher productivity, higher wages, which can then be reinvested to develop the firms further. Let me now touch on the next important ingredient, developing the right skills. Now, when firms create the right jobs, our people must also develop the right skills to take on these jobs. And preparing our people for the future starts from an early age, when our children develop the fundamentals and the love for learning. As Associate Professor Fatima Latif, Mr. Darrell David, Mr. Rahayu Mazam, and other members have said, we must build the confidence of our young, broaden their learning, and stimulate their curiosity as early as possible. It is a powerful force that will keep them learning and help them overcome challenges in their lives. To deepen lifelong learning, we launched Skills Future, with a focus not just on skills of today, but also skills for tomorrow. Now, actually, we have made good progress. And let me cite some data. In 2015, over 260,000 residents took up WSQ courses. 22,000 were enrolled in part-time diploma, post-diploma, and degree-level programs in our polytechnics and publicly funded universities. Now, I salute our people for this diligence. In fact, I've met many people who are pursuing part-time courses, and I know it's not easy juggling the demands of work, family, and studies. And so really, this spirit of resilience and lifelong learning is most commendable. The success of SkillsFuture depends on everyone playing their part, not just employees, but also employers. So the government will provide support and resources for those who are willing and motivated to acquire new skills and deepen their skill sets. So under SkillsFuture, we are developing an online individualized learning portal for individuals to plan their careers and lifelong learning. The portal will be launched in phases starting from 2017. And some of you will be happy to know this, accounts will be given to students from primary 5 and upwards so that they can begin to plan their future learning and skills development. So we are taking your comments about starting young quite seriously. So this initiative, it will equip our young people with critical skills for the workplace and the capacity to learn throughout their lives. So I've touched on right jobs, right skills. Now, we need a right match. Now, job seekers, including those currently in employment, can avail themselves of a suite of employment and training assistance. This includes professional conversion programs and a career support program. WDA and NTUC's Employment and Employability Institute, or E2I, help match workers and jobs and provide training to improve their employability of workers through their career centres. They have successfully placed over 14,000 job seekers in 2015. So 14,000 job seekers, quite an impressive number. And besides employment and training assistance, wage support is also provided in some cases. So this year's budget builds on these programs with the launch of the Adapt and Grow program, which will provide support for more Singaporeans to reskill and gain employment. As I mentioned in the budget statement, we expect to more than double the current outreach for PMATs from 2,000 to over 4,000. So we understand the anxiety of some who have been displaced, and that's why this program is being enhanced and doubled. So the Minister for Manpower will speak further on this at the COS. Now, as new industries and new types of jobs emerge, we'll need to take our skills and job matching efforts even further. We too have to innovate in this area. And that's why we are launching the Tech Skills Accelerator for the ICT sector. It will pilot a new model for how government partners major IT employers, associations, and industry to offer training, certification, and job matching services, 3-in-1. You also reach out to those without ICT background to develop skill sets. And some of you may ask, you know, is it possible to develop ICT skill sets without background? Well, there are certain specific areas that IDS identified, such as user experience and user interface design. If this pilot succeeds, we will replicate it in other sectors, as many of you have suggested. Now, what is critical to sustain the long-term vitality of our labour markets? No short-term fixes, but long-term vitality. Several members have listed the various market innovations over the years in managing our dependence on foreign manpower, promoting local employment, and helping vulnerable groups of workers to find jobs and supplement their incomes. Now, I thank all members for the thought and care that you have put into suggesting improvements to our labour markets and skills development. Professor Randolph Tan proposed auctioning the right to hire foreign manpower. Mr. Desmond Chu suggested broadening the apprenticeship system and partnering the labour movement on career guidance for young people. Mr. Zainal Sapari suggested further ways to help our low-wage workers. Mr. Patrick Tay suggested enhancements to the career support program and setting up support network for unemployed PMATs. Dr. Teo Ho Pin suggested setting up centers of excellence for skills future learning in partnership with trade associations and professional bodies. Mr. Lim Biao Chuan, Mr. Asmoon Ahmad, and other members spoke about providing retrenchment benefits to Singaporeans. Now, we'll study these proposals carefully. I'll just want to echo a point which Professor Randolph Tan also made, that we must be careful about how we intervene in the labour market. We cannot simply copy one bit from one country and then another piece from another and hope to make sense of it. There has to be a clear philosophy and a clear sense that the various measures must cohere to be effective over the long term. Again, no short-term quick fixes, but a game plan, a clear philosophy, and a sense of how different pieces must cohere. And importantly, we must not undermine the sense of independence and efficacy and the spirit of self-reliance and resilience in our people. Now, let me end off this section by sharing a story which Mr. Heng Chee Hao and many members will find inspiring. I met Mr. Sundaram Velosamy and Mr. Ong Mo Hong when I visited Pan Asia Logistics, or PAL. Now, Mr. Sundaram is an interesting story because he started working in the logistics sector in 1989 with an O-level certificate. He has a keen desire to learn and upgraded himself by studying part-time for certificates and diploma qualifications. And building on each other, building on one another, he got a degree in 2013. And after he joined PAL in 2012, he was sent to Germany for training to understand how to use the automated storage and retrieval system. Now, when he returned, he applied what he learned and increased their productivity significantly. Now, Mr. Ong joined the firm in 2014 at the age of 66, just as the firm was implementing a new IT system. Now, age was not a barrier either for Mr. Ong or his employer. Now, interestingly, Mr. Ong has been doing logistics work for 29 years, all the while in manual positions. And when I asked him, how does it feel to now join a firm which is just starting an IT system? He said, wow, it's a great opportunity to learn. So he learned how to operate the new IT processes when he joined the firm at the age of 66. So today, Mr. Ong and Mr. Sundaram are role models for the team and help mentor younger staff. And as Mr. Sundaram said, and I quote, there's no use if I keep it to myself. I must pass on the knowledge to others. I must mentor them so that they can do better and also mentor others, unquote. So again, this is a very good example of lifelong learning, of mentoring, of a company that invests in developing its staff, and importantly, of treasuring workers, senior workers, and believing that training, that you can continue to train older workers. As Mr. Heng said, they too have a long runway. So I commend Mr. Ong and Mr. Sundaram for the pursuit of lifelong learning and PAL for creating an inclusive culture of constant development for their staff. Now, our approach to enable our people to access good jobs and stay employable can be encapsulated in one phrase. Right jobs, right skills, right match. Creating full employment and good jobs is a major challenge, a difficult journey. But I'm confident that we will be ready for the future because I have confidence in Singaporeans and I have confidence in Singapore. And I have confidence that we will work together. Now, let me now talk about the spirit of caring and resilience. Many members, including Dr. Lim Wee Kiak and Ms. Joan Pereira, highlighted the importance of empowering our seniors to lead active and engaged lives. Mr. Faisal Manab, Mr. Darrell David, and Mr. Christopher D'Souza, and a number of MPs talk about government support for families and the needs of the young. I'm heartened that many MPs, including Dr. Tan Wu Meng and Mr. Henry Kwek, support the initiatives to encourage philanthropy and volunteerism. Now, I'll focus on three main topics: strengthening social support, reaching Singaporeans in need, and building a caring and resilient society. Now, Mr. Vikram Nair and Ms. Rahayu Mazam spoke about the need to support low-income families, especially those with children. We invest in all our children to help them achieve their potential, paying particular attention from those from less advantaged backgrounds. Housing subsidies that help low and middle income families own their home have been increased. And we're now looking beyond general affordability. Fresh Start will help some families own a home again if they're willing to work hard for a second chance. And I thank Mr. Satyandi Supat for supporting this scheme. Preschool subsidies have been increased significantly. Low-income families pay as little as $3 a month for childcare and $1 a month for kindergarten. Middle-income families also get support. We are going further for a small group of young children who may need even more support. The Kickstart pilot will draw together government and community resources to provide these children with learning, developmental, and health support, even before they enter school. There are now more resources for families, regardless of income. For each eligible child, parents may receive a baby bonus cash gift of $8,000 or $10,000, depending on birth order, the MediSave grants for newborns of $4,000, and now the new CDA First Step grant of $3,000. In total, parents of eligible children receive between $15,000 and $17,000 in the first 18 months of their child's birth. By the way, this is in addition to tax reliefs and other leave benefits. A child who attends primary and secondary school also receives around $11,000 a year in educational subsidies. And a child from a lower-income family, a lower-income household, will receive more. There are also substantial subsidies for all Singaporean students at our institutes of higher learning and bursaries from those from lower-income families. Now, I must also point out to Mr. Dennis Tan that apart from the CDA grant, the baby bonus cash gift and the MediSave grant for newborns do not, I emphasize, do not require co-matching. Moreover, our preschool and education subsidies benefit all, but are especially generous to children from lower and middle income families. So if you take a look at it in its entirety, across all the different schemes, substantial support is given for supporting parents to have children, to all, in fact, but especially for the middle income households, and with even more targeted support for those who start with less. And so while the CDA First Step is $3,000, we must not forget that there are existing baby cash bonus of $8,000 or $10,000 plus MediSave grant of $4,000. Now, Ms. Jessica Tan earlier raised the issue about the assurance for seniors in retirement, and several members have also spoken on this. So let me now touch on this subject. Over the last 10 years, we have also strengthened the four pillars of our social security system, namely home ownership, healthcare assurance, CPF, and workfare. In particular, we have provided our seniors with greater assurance. Through CPF Life and MediShield Life, we are increasing risk pooling to provide more support in the face of life's uncertainties and also during retirement. This has been complemented by increased government subsidies for seniors across all healthcare settings, including subsidies for MediShield Life premiums, GP clinics via CHAS, and for elder care. We also pay extra interest on CPF, with the first $30,000 in CPF earning up to 6% interest from the age of 55. The workfare income supplement has been further enhanced in this budget. So I thank Mr. Gan Tian Po for his support for the enhancements to workfare, and would like to clarify to Mr. Pritam Singh that as I announced in my budget speech, we are raising the qualifying income ceiling to $2,000, not $1,900. With the past enhancements, WIS is now a significant supplement for low-income workers of up to 30% of their income. Besides workfare, the Pioneer Generation package provides a special generation with additional support. So again, adding up our transfers to retiree households, including healthcare subsidies, SNCC rebates, and the GST voucher, we provide substantial support for retirees living in one and two-room HDB flats. Now, even if we consider only those living in three-room and larger HDB flats, larger meaning up to executive apartments, on average, this worked out to around $5,000 in government transfers per retiree in 2015. And about 70% of this is in healthcare subsidies. So substantial support for our seniors. Silver support is a major enhancement to our social security system. I thank members, including Ms. Jessica Tan and Mr. Zaki Muhammad, for their and several others, for their suggestions to look into the criteria for silver support. So let me now touch on 3 points. First, let me reiterate, the silver support is a modest but meaningful supplement targeted at the bottom 20% of seniors, with some support extended to the next 10%. In implementing the scheme, we are mindful of the impact silver support can have on our society. Many Singaporeans are proud to be able to provide for their loved ones. Silver support is not meant to replace other forms of financial support for our seniors, including personal savings, CPF, family support, as well as a Pioneer Generation package. We must be cautious that silver support does not undermine values such as filial piety or lead to a divisive mentality among citizens. But silver support is not the only source of help for the neediest seniors whose basic income needs are served by public assistance, which has also been enhanced in this budget. Yeah, as to how public assistance and silver support will work together, we'll address this later. Now, the second point I want to make is this. No single criterion is enough to identify seniors in the bottom 20 to 30%. So it's therefore reasonable that we combine three criteria of lifetime wages, housing type, and household support in our assessment. Now, we acknowledge that there may be some seniors, as highlighted by Mr. Lim Biao Chuan and Mr. Darryl David and several others, who may need help but do not qualify automatically. Seniors in these exceptional circumstances can request CPF Board to review their eligibility for silver support and will consider the merits of each case. Finally, we have to carefully calibrate the coverage of silver support. It starts off with $320 million a year and will increase. Will increase as our population ages. So from the outset, we should ensure that the scheme remains sustainable in the long run. Mr. Alex Yam asked whether payouts can be made monthly instead of quarterly. Now, I'll point out that unlike workfare, which is given for work done, silver support provides a forward payment, paying ahead in 3-month tranches. So it's a forward payment. So this gives seniors the flexibility to manage their expenses, because in fact we are paying, giving greater flexibility. And if we move to monthly payments, it will reduce such flexibility. Several members requested greater support for caregivers through some form of monetary compensation. Now, I recognize that it's not easy to be a caregiver, and I've met many and have great respect for what they do. But as a society, we have to be careful not to monetize relationship. And this is a subject that will have to be carefully studied, and MOH and MSF will elaborate on the relevant efforts at their COS. Now, I also like to commend Ms. Chia Yong Yong for her very moving plea for all of us to better understand persons with disabilities. I strongly agree that we should continue to empower them to realize their full potential. MSF will elaborate on the third review of the Enabling Master Plan in their COS. Now, let me now address an issue which several of you have raised, which is about support for middle-income households. So Ms. Tana Lachimi and Mr. Asmoon Ahmad asked why there is no tax rebate or, more broadly, measures targeted at the middle income in this budget. Now, to begin with, about half of our workers do not pay any income tax. The income tax burden is low for the majority who pay, including the middle income group. Now, I had earlier spoken on our efforts to strengthen existing measures that benefit middle-income households and provide active support for housing, education, and healthcare. And SkillsFuture is another example. Now, all these measures are not as direct as putting money in people's pockets, but it has meaningful long-term impact on the careers and future of Singaporeans. And the most important support for all Singaporeans, including the middle income, is employability and good jobs. A point which Ms. Tana mentioned at a recent TV program, that the best social security is a job security, and I would add that the best way to ensure job security is deep skills and adaptability. And that is why we are investing in those areas. And as I said before, even though I devoted a considerable amount of time in this budget to explain the industry transformation program and measures to support our SMEs, our aim is very clear: to enable Singaporeans to have good jobs, more opportunities, and a better life. And we have to go for the long haul, and these are important ways to support all families, especially middle-income families. So providing a tax rebate, you know, from year to year does not address the fundamental concerns of our middle-income group. We must, as Associate Professor Fatima Latif pointed out, preserve a spirit of resilience and self-reliance and focus on a sustainable way to build better lives for all. Now, let me now touch on reaching Singaporeans in need. As we spend more, we must take extra care to spend well. So I welcome Ms. Sharon Chan's comments on the importance of improving the way care is delivered, especially for the elderly. Let me share my thoughts on how we can maximize the impact and reach of our schemes. To better serve Singaporeans, we have made some moves to improve service delivery in the last mile, especially to the elderly and vulnerable. The first is reaching out proactively to those in need. Now, a good example is the Pioneer Generation Ambassadors, which Ms. Ching Li Hui spoke about. Over the past 1.5 years, they have reached out to 250,000 pioneers, or 60%, to explain the benefits of the PGP and MediShield Life. And our ambassadors form a close relationship with their pioneers, explain government policies to them, and help them access the various schemes. So let me share with you how our ambassadors reach out. An example is Mr. Shahu Hamid and his wife. Mr. Shahu is 74 years old with a heart condition and usually stays at home. Our ambassadors visited him to explain the benefits of the PGP and MediShield Life, and they also took the chance to introduce Mr. Shahu to active aging programs in his community to help him make friends while keeping fit, while taking care of his heart condition. And these are practical ways in which we are reaching out proactively. The second move is to bring help closer. Previously, those looking for short and medium-term assistance under ComCare had to approach one of the 5 CDCs. Today, they can approach 24 social service officers, or SSOs, across the island for assistance. And along with family service centres, 95% of the island's residents who need help have access to help within 2 kilometres, within 2 kilometres of where they live or work. Now, this is an important milestone, but we're still striving to bring help closer to those in need. And with more experience, we'll do better. The third move is integrating assistance from government agencies and VWOs. We are expanding Social Service Net, or the SSNet, our integrated information sharing and case management system that links MSF with other government agencies as well as VWOs. Agencies can better calibrate their support to help each citizen and better address their needs. Administrative hassle, especially paperwork and forms with multiple agencies, will be reduced for citizens. And I think this is especially important for those who need help, as Dr. Tan Wu Meng has mentioned. But we can do even better in partnering the community. We can do better. So I was extremely heartened by my visit to Henderson Dawson Ward and the Tongking Senior Activity Centre last week. Now, this area is one of the older estates, with almost 1 in 6 of the residents aged 65 or over. Now, many more neighbourhoods will be like Henderson Dawson. So it's important to ensure that every neighbourhood is a good neighbourhood for seniors to age with dignity, lead active and healthy lives, and stay engaged with the community. Yeah. Well, I'm glad it resonates with all of you. Every neighbourhood, a good neighbourhood for seniors. Yeah. Now, forging close-knit partnerships is key. Henderson Dawson is an example of how various parties come together with good leadership of advisors. Now, it was difficult at the start, but over time, the various partners built trust to work together and pool resources to better meet seniors' needs. And this includes activities like seniors, for seniors like morning exercises, free lunches, and educational talks on topics from nutrition to fire safety. Now, by the way, there's an interesting history on how this got built up, because I happened to speak to Dr. Vasu, who started that program. And in turn, Dr. Vasu's program was built on by Ms. Indrani and now by Ms. Joan Pereira. And so that, I think that continual effort is helpful. Now, the elderly themselves contribute to these efforts to help care for one another. Now, they demonstrate a keen sense of collective responsibility and feel a strong obligation to the community. So I echo Ms. Joan Pereira and Ms. Ting Pei Ling's call for more senior citizens to volunteer. It's a good way to stay active and engaged. MCCY will provide an update on the Silver Volunteer Fund, which encourages seniors to give up their time for good causes in their COS. I would like to share the story of Madam Chia Chen Kam, who is 70 years old. Now, Madam Chen is the one in the center. Her husband passed away a few years ago. However, she discovered a new meaning in life when she started volunteering at the center. And she said, and I quote in Mandarin, but she spoke in Mandarin,
I should give back to the society what I have received from it. Unless I cannot move and I have no way out, whatever I can do, I will definitely still continue to help.
Having received from society, it is only right that I give back. Unless I cannot move and I have no way, whatever I can do, I will definitely continue to help. This is a great feisty attitude of an elderly, great resilience and great sense of care for others. These are very moving and inspiring words. So we must all step forward to care for our fellow Singaporeans and renew our shared commitment to building a better society. And this is particularly important as our population ages. So community partnership will be a major area of focus moving forward. The community networks for seniors, the pilot will bring local stakeholders and agencies together to study the needs of seniors and help them take preventive care. And looking ahead, as several of you have suggested, we can even do better to plan our estates and social services, as well as crowd in the community to make Singapore a model for social service delivery, as well as successful ageing. Now, ultimately, it's not about government schemes, but about building a caring and resilient society. As Mr. Kok Heng Leun said, we must all pitch in to take care of one another and solve community problems together. And this is the only way we can nourish the ties that bind us together as a society. Over the past 2 years, the government provided $500 million in matching grants for the Care and Share movement. I'm delighted that this has generated significant donations from the public. More importantly, over 200,000 volunteers participated. Singaporeans have shown great generosity in spirit, and we hope that this can be sustained. So we'll continue to encourage charitable giving by matching dollar for dollar any additional donations through Share to Comchest. Besides providing resources, businesses have a role in helping the social sector and supporting employee volunteerism. Let me give two examples. Quirk, a local integrated marketing communications agency, supports Project Dreamcatchers, an initiative by NUH to empower youths living with chronic illness. The youths will be producing artwork. They'll be showcased in an exhibition later this year, and Quirk is assisting with the branding and collaterals. A group of drivers in ComfortDelGro are active volunteers, delivering meals and driving around those in need. And these are all examples where businesses and employees use their expertise for good causes. The Business and IPC Partnership Scheme pilot is designed to support more partnerships between businesses and institutions of public character and encourage employee volunteerism. I acknowledge the issues raised by Mr. Nispoa, including possible crowding out of cash donations, over-subsidizing volunteerism, and the cap that affects IPCs that really need help. Now, we studied these issues and decided to pilot the scheme to push businesses towards volunteerism, to encourage businesses towards volunteerism, but with appropriate caps. And our larger intention is to kickstart a movement beyond cash donations to get businesses to mobilize resources. And we'll monitor it's a pilot, and we'll monitor this carefully. But let me stress that at the end of the day, it's not about tax incentives. It's not about tax incentives. At the end of the day, it's about businesses seeing themselves as responsible corporate citizens and becoming more active partners in building a caring society. Finally, I was heartened by the enthusiastic response to last year's SG50 Celebration Fund, with passionate Singaporeans coming forward to celebrate our Jubilee year. We'll make it easier for Singaporeans to enrich our society with ground-up initiatives. And as many members have pointed out, it is not through the government's efforts alone, but a collective effort that we can build a caring and resilient society. We hope that Singaporeans from all walks of life will step forward. Over the past few days, several members, including Mr. Liang Ying-hua, Mr. Chong Ki-hyung, Ms. Foo Mi-ha, and Mr. Henry Kwek, have spoken on the importance of fiscal sustainability, even as we tackle Singapore's economic and social challenges. As members pointed out, Singapore's spending needs will grow in the coming years. First, healthcare. Over the next 10 to 15 years, we will experience a rapid aging of our population. Today, 1 in 8 Singaporeans is aged 65 and above. This will double to 1 in 4 Singaporeans in 15 years. Now, in some areas, such as Outram, the future is already here, with 1 in 5 residents aged 65 and above. An older population will invariably mean an increase in healthcare needs. For instance, the hospital admission rate for elderly today is 3 to 4 times that of younger people, 3 to 4 times. Countries such as Japan went through a similar experience. Over the last 25 years, Japan's healthcare spending has doubled as its proportion of elderly doubled. Singapore's experience will not completely mirror Japan's, but our healthcare spending will certainly rise, and we must prepare adequately for our needs. Second, we will need to refresh our infrastructure and build new ones to create new economic opportunities and better homes for the next 50 years. For public transport, we'll be investing significantly more over the next 5 years. This includes the doubling of the rail network from 178 kilometers today to about 360 kilometers in 2030, the same time that our proportion of elderly reaches 1 in 4. Changi Airport T5 will be developed to enhance our connectivity to Asia and globally. And third, we must continue to invest in our defense and security, which underpin our economic and social prosperity. As Mr. Christopher De Souza and Dr. Lim Wee Kiak have noted, the threats of terrorism and cyber attacks have grown. So to keep our homes safe, we must invest. Now, as our must-haves and good-to-haves increase over time, Mr. Sitoh Yih Pin correctly pointed out that we must continue to uphold the principle of living within our means so that we create enduring benefits and not enlarging burden. Enduring benefits and not enlarging burden for ourselves, our children, and our grandchildren. While our spending needs are growing, our revenue growth will be slowing as our economy matures. The experiences of many advanced countries warn us how easy it is for spending to become unsustainable and impose a growing burden on future generations. So how then should we ensure that our spending needs are met? First, we must place priority on building a vibrant economy, which will then grow our revenue. A vibrant, competitive economy creates opportunities and jobs for our people and generates the revenue to meet our needs. Second, we must spend prudently and spend right. This is about being efficient and being effective so that each dollar reaches out to the right groups to help them in the right way. And third, we must design our overall fiscal system so that it is fair and progressive. We must tax and spend in a way that is progressive without disincentivizing enterprise and efforts. So our system of revenues and expenditure must always be fair and progressive. Only then can it be sustainable across generations. Several MPs have asked if our personal income tax relief cap, which serves to increase progressivity, runs contradictory to encouraging procreation. Engineer Dr. Lee Bee Hua, Ms. Joan Pereira, and Ms. Ting Pei Ling have commented on this, and I thank you for your views and for reflecting residents' views. Let me explain. We have introduced a cap on personal income tax reliefs to apply to the total amount of all reliefs claimed. There are 15 personal income tax reliefs, each serving a worthy objective. Taken together, however, they can unduly reduce total taxable income for a small proportion of individuals. After studying the reliefs, we concluded that we needed to moderate the effects of large amounts of reliefs claimed in order to preserve equity in our tax structure. We have to maintain fairness between different groups of taxpayers, in particular, between those who earn more and those who earn less. We have thus imposed a cap to make our personal income tax more progressive. Let me emphasize once again that a vast majority of taxpayers are unaffected by the caps. 99% of tax resident individuals can continue to claim their reliefs fully. And for those claiming working mothers' child relief, even with the cap, 9 in 10 of those claiming working mothers' child relief are not affected. Even if they're capped, 9 in 10 are not affected. And this includes those with more children, Slightly over 8 in 10 individuals claiming working mother's child relief on 2 or 3 children are not expected to be affected by the cap. Now, over the years, we have added and significantly enhanced various schemes to support parents in having children. I touched earlier on our substantial support for marriage and parenthood, including the baby bonus gifts, MediSave grants, and the child development account, and now the First Step grant. And as I pointed out, subsidies to all Singaporean children for education in school, at preschool, and at the institutes of higher learning are all very significant. In fact, the educational subsidies swamped many of this. So with all these measures, it is clear that the government remains committed to supporting Singaporeans in fulfilling their marriage and parenthood aspirations. The government remains committed to supporting Singaporeans in fulfilling their marriage and parenthood aspirations. And in fact, our support for families also extends beyond monetary support and includes our wider push to make it easier for families to balance their work and life commitments. And this includes our recent efforts to extend parental leave. As Engineer Dr. Bee Hua pointed out, yes, it's about having the right mindset. Fundamentally, having a child is about the joy of parenthood. SMS Josephine Teo, in charge of the MPTD, will elaborate more on our marriage and parenthood strategy during the COS. Now, from time to time, we have to make adjustments to our schemes in order to continue targeting our support at those who need it. But we should not be evaluating budget measures solely from the individual's perspective in a particular year. Which will be narrowly focused on individual winners and losers. We must avoid thinking, as Ms. Kwek Siao Yin eloquently put it, that we are in a, I quote, high-stakes competition of win-lose, unquote, and that there is no win-win. Instead, our larger goal is to make every Singaporean a winner in the long run, And this must be our goal. It cannot be otherwise. When we help one group, we are actually helping others too. When we support our SMEs, we are supporting good jobs for our workers. When we support our seniors, we are helping the families who are taking care of them. When we invest in our young to help them maximize their potential and seize opportunities and have a good career, we are also helping to ensure that they have the means to support their own families when they start one, as well as support their loved ones, their parents, in their retirement. And when we keep our tax burden low, especially for the middle income, everyone benefits. So we have to see in totality, and over the long term, and not just one measure or another, one group versus another, and one year versus another year. It has to be seen in totality over the long run. Madam Speaker, let me now conclude. I come back to our journey together towards the future. This is a long-distance journey. We are in this to keep Singapore going and thriving for the long, long haul. This is our responsibility to future generations. To take this journey, we have to keep our eyes on the road, keep our eyes on the horizon, and keep our eyes out for the people we journey with. Keep our eyes on the road. Every journey, even the longest journey, is taken one step at a time. And so too with a country. Though we keep our sights on the distant future, we move towards it one budget at a time. If we gaze upon the distance and don't look at the road immediately in front of us, we risk falling into a hole and we'll never reach our destination, or we will take injury and recovery before we get there. So in this budget, we have taken targeted steps to address short-term pressures to make sure that we don't fall into the hole. So I urge members to help those who are facing pressures to make the best use they can of the measures which we announced. Now, keep our eyes on the horizon. We have to know our directions, and we have to know ourselves. How far do we hope to go? And how do we have it in us to go that distance? And we have to budget for our journey. We can't use up all our supplies at the start, and we have to have ways to grow our store of supplies. We have to spend more as our needs grow, so we must continue to grow our economy so that we can have resources to spend more on growing needs. We must continue to spend those resources wisely. It's not possible for government to keep handing out goodies for everyone year after year, as several of you pointed out. Instead, each budget must build on the previous ones to carry forward the momentum to future budgets. How do we keep our eyes on the horizon? Our firms need to look outwards and look forward to find new markets, grow capabilities, transform. Look ahead, see opportunities where others see only problems. The Committee on the Future Economy will continue that looking towards the horizon to plot out what we can of the road ahead so that we can take the right steps for a vibrant, strong future economy that creates good opportunities for our people. Each of us, too, must continually learn, get the skills the world needs, and we must have the resilience to overcome personal setbacks and adapt to change. For this reason, we will keep investing in Skills Future. I hope Singaporeans will make full use of Skills Future and that all employers do their part to redesign jobs, facilitate learning, and build a better future, not just for the companies, but for the people who help the companies to run. And the government must know when to step in and when to step back. We must not inadvertently undermine the spirit of enterprise and the natural workings of markets, or undermine the spirit of caring and resilience, such that we weaken the bonds of family and community. Instead, we must reinforce critical values and our spirits as a society. Resources, hard-won and wisely managed, will nourish us for the road ahead. Our values and our spirits, these are what will truly energize our journey. The last thing we have to do for this journey is to keep our eyes out for the people who journey with us. Madam, I believe that none of us wants to reach that destination alone. The purpose of this journey is to journey together and to reach our destination together as one united, cohesive people. To me, there's no meaning to this journey unless it is a common journey. So we must look out and care for one another as we journey. Is someone getting tired? Is someone struggling? What can we do to keep all of us going together? At the heart of this, we must recognize that every member of our society is not just valuable, but precious. We must have the resilience in us to face each challenge as an opportunity, to learn and grow, to emerge from setbacks better and stronger. We must have that humility in us to respect and learn from everyone, no matter what their paper qualification or job title. And we must have the generosity to share, be it in actual things, time, or ideas. I do believe, Madam, the more we share, the richer we are for it. By giving and sharing, this is how we transform our world and how we may ourselves may be transformed for the better. We have sought in Budget 2016 to strengthen our resilience and bring out a natural instinct for care and partnership in all of us. So, keep our eyes on the road, keep our eyes on the horizon, and keep our eyes out for one another. Madam, we have a long road ahead. I thank this House for the attention it has given to Budget 2016, our first step in our journey towards SG 100. It will be bumpy. It will be full of unknowns. Amongst the unknowns are not just challenges, but victories. There are many innovations ahead of us that we cannot yet imagine. Many personal and shared triumphs. Many moments of humanity, unity and beauty that will keep defining our Singapore. Through all the good and bad, through all the good and bad unknowns of the years to come, I hope our spirit of enterprise and caring will run strong. I'm honored and excited to partner fellow Singaporeans on this journey. Let's get to work together.